and Schuster Audio presents A Promise to Kill, a Clyde Barr novel by Erik Storey, read by Pete Simonelli.
For the world's indigenous peoples. There are not enough Indians in the world to defeat the 7th Cavalry. George Armstrong Custer. Chapter 1. The second time I saw the old Ute, he was dying. It was late summer, hot and drier even than usual. I was riding a new mare and leading a reluctant mule named Bob across the lowlands of northeast Utah that lay between the hump of the Book Cliffs and the higher Uinta Mountains to the north. When I saw the old man's truck idling in the bar ditch, I let go of Bob's lead rope and kicked the mare into a half gallop, jumped off and let the reins hang as I checked on the old man. He sat slumped against the steering wheel of his rusty 20-year-old pickup and was complaining that his arm hurt and that he had some serious indigestion. I told him to hang on, rummaged in my pack, and pulled out a bottle of expired aspirin. "I'm fine," the old man said. "Just ate a bad lunch. You don't need to worry about me." "No, you're not. Here, take these." I shoved a couple of pills in his mouth and made him chew. He grimaced, which made his aged face look even older. "Tasty, huh?" I said. "I'm no doctor, but I think your ticker's giving out. Try not to die for a second. I'll be right back." I tied my mare and the mule to some nearby pinyons and went back to the truck. The old man looked like he was concentrating, trying to control his breathing. He rubbed his arm and clutched his shirt. "Ain't my ticker. I have the heart of a warrior. Strong." He thumped his chest feebly, and the grimace returned. I dug back into my pack and found my cell phone, which was dead, of course. There aren't many places to plug a charger into a horse. "We need to get you to a hospital." He nodded, grunted, and tried to unbuckle his seatbelt. I slipped my knife from its sheath and cut the strap before he could struggle it off, then ran to the other side of the vehicle and helped him into the passenger seat. Once I got him halfway comfortable, I hopped in the driver's seat and tried to remember how to drive an old ranch pickup. The gears were sloppy, the clutch slipped, and the engine loped like a panicked Appaloosa I once owned. The knack of relying on mechanical horsepower, not the animal kind, came back to me a few miles later. As the old codger and I rattled down the dusty, narrow highway, I thought back to the first time we'd met, 20 minutes before. I'd been sitting atop my horse, trotting across the gray asphalt, when the old man had stopped and waved me over. "Nice pony," he'd said. The clipped way he'd said it, combined with his dark, wrinkled skin, told me he was a native. That was the politically correct term these days. I remembered playing cowboys and Indians as a kid. These days, I guess kids played something PC, like good guys and bad guys. According to the map in my pack, I was getting close to the Uinta and Ute Indian reservation. This old man proved I was closer than I'd thought. "She's a little tall to be a pony," I said as an understatement. The mare stood at least 16 hands. The old man laughed, his skin a map of deep canyons and craters. "I raise ponies just like that," he said. "On my ranch, quarter horses, not as full of fight as the ponies my great-grandfather rode into war, but pretty good." He laughed again, then asked where I was going. I shrugged. "North, I guess." It didn't much matter where, as long as I was moving. Although it would be nice to get up into the range that I've been riding toward the last couple of days. The cold granite, crystal water, and tall, fragrant pines would help fix what was eating away at me. "You should come by," he said. "Cook me dinner and I'll tell you some stories." I told him I would, and I'd planned on it, but I'd barely ridden 2 miles before I came to his idling pickup. Now, as the sun sank low in the sky and the surrounding stubby juniper and pinyon trees cast grotesque shadows across the road, I divided my time between trying to keep the old beater of a truck on the pavement and glimpsing over at this man I barely knew, whose condition seemed to be worsening. "You still with me?" I asked. He grunted and motioned vaguely with his hand. "Go to Wakara. Straight ahead 5 miles. My daughter works at the clinic there. She's a doctor, a good one. She'll take care of me." I did as he said, driving through a long, narrow cut that had rock walls rising up on either side, but I had to stop a couple of times to remove some debris that had probably fallen off a flatbed and would have shredded the truck's tires. When we finally got into what barely passed for a town, the sun had disappeared behind the rocky horizon and the clinic was closed. "Where's the nearest phone?" He shrugged, pointed to the only building out of the 10 or so in town that had a light burning. I drove there, told the man to sit tight, and walked toward the door. As I neared the slumping building, I heard the rumble of laughter and jeering. The place looked like it wouldn't make it through the winter. The outside walls were a mix of peeling plaster, missing windows, and artful graffiti. The inside was worse. Chapter 2. Once I opened the front door, my nose caught the pungent scents of dried leather and manure, and my eyes took in the sight of rows and rows of haphazardly placed goods for sale. On one wall were tightly packed clothes, and on another was an assortment of hunting and fishing supplies. Occupying the room's center were stacked cases of canned goods and packaged food. Where the back wall should have been was a recessed area that featured a bar. And in front of that bar were at least 20 loud, burly bikers in leather jackets and chaps. Surprisingly, all were white. No natives in sight, despite the fact that I was officially now standing inside an Indian reservation. There was no one manning the small checkout counter by the door, so I waded into the boisterous room. "Hey," I yelled, barely able to make my voice heard above the drunken racket. "Is there a phone here?" The room went quiet, which gave me time to notice details, like the patches on the bikers' jackets. Their club was apparently called the Reapers, and they were one percenters, what they called the hardest of the hard. I'd met bikers before and seen outlaw patches similar to these. Normally, they wouldn't have bothered me. What did bother me was the way these men held themselves. Most were leaner and more muscled than the bikers you see on TV or in the movies. But more important was their eyes. They were full of menace. For some reason, this crew reminded me of the Janjaweed, a deadly horseback militia in Sudan that I'd once made the mistake of upsetting. The biggest of the men, a giant who must have topped 6'6", shoved his way ahead and moved to stand in front of me. His patches said he was the club's president and that his name was Jury. "No phone. Stores closed for a private party. Leave." I could feel his hot breath on my beard. His men smiled. I said, "I've got an old man outside. He's in bad shape. I need to borrow someone's phone." Jury grabbed a beer bottle out of the nearest biker's hand and slammed it to the floor. Glass shattered and tinkled against my boots. "Let him die." For an instant, I tried to assess how much of this stone-cold killer response was an act. Maybe he was just testing me, waiting to see if I'd offer the secret bad guy handshake or whatever. Should I say something clever? At that moment, I couldn't think of a single comeback other than, "I can't." At that, Jury's friend's eyebrows all raised like coordinated curtains, and 20 heads shifted slightly to see what the president's next move would be.
"I think you will."
"Won't." I didn't move. Instead, I matched his stare.
"Listen, bumpkin," he said. "When our club rolls into a little town like yours, we own it. We make the rules and we make the demands."
He stared hard at his men, paying special attention to a couple of the sloppier reapers wearing nomad patches, the only ones who weren't yet coiled for action.
"We also say who lives and who dies. And if you don't leave in the next 3 seconds, you and your friend outside will both be dead."
Time slowed as I fought to control my adrenaline. 20 bikers continued to stare at me like hungry hyenas at night, waiting to see if they could feed. My hands shook. I wanted, more than I'd wanted anything in a long time, to pop Jury in the throat and wade into his friends with chin jabs. But there was an old man dying outside. So I put my hands up and backed away.
That's right. Walk away, Bumpkin. Go play with the Indians. And if you ever interrupt us again, I'll stomp you into six kinds of flat. Chapter 3. It was full dark when I hurried back outside and climbed into the truck. In the glow of its overhead light, the old man seemed paler. Beads of sweat broke off his forehead and ran into his eyes. He didn't wipe them away. "Still hanging in there?" I asked. It took him a moment to answer. "Don't worry about me. Even at 80, I'm strong."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.